very much. So I'm going to start off this afternoon by talking about water. So here we have our magnificent blue planet. Abundant water, or so it seems until we add to this picture 7 billion people. And now we're increasingly hearing the phrase freshwater security. And what I'm going to do today is to zoom in and talk about freshwater security in the Monterey Bay region, where fresh water is challenging us to think about how we can ensure that there's adequate fresh water for people while not damaging the natural systems that provide that water. So here we are, we've arrived in the Monterey Bay region. Now, where does the fresh water come from that's the supply of water for this region? Well, there's very little surface water. So most of the water comes from groundwater. Groundwater is that water that's held below the surface, meters to hundreds of meters below the surface, in regions referred to as groundwater aquifers. Groundwater aquifers are a great place to store water. So many people think of groundwater aquifers like we think about savings accounts. It's there for a rainy day. Although in the case of groundwater aquifers, it's there for those days when it doesn't rain. But it's a great place to store water. In this area, we've become very dependent upon our groundwater. When we look at the percent of fresh water used that is groundwater, the national average is 44%. Statewide, 30%. Santa Cruz County, 79% of the water comes from groundwater. Monterey County, 99% of your groundwater, of your fresh water, is coming from this groundwater. Much of the demand for water in this area is driven by agriculture. And agriculture from this area is an important part of the food supply in the country and an essential part of the local economy. So we can't just stop providing water for agriculture. So freshwater security in this region challenges us to think, how can we continue to use our groundwater, but in a way that is not threatening the long-term viability of our groundwater aquifers? So what's the concern along this coast? The concern is saltwater intrusion. All along this coast, you're getting your groundwater from groundwater aquifers that are present at various depths below the surface. In this simple schematic, I have two groundwater aquifers. When we pump water from the upper aquifer, we can potentially start pulling salt water into that aquifer. When I then turn and pump water from the lower aquifer, you can start pulling salt water into that lower aquifer. And that's what's happening all along this coast. When we look at aquifers at various depths, there is evidence of saltwater intrusion at various depths into a number of these aquifers. Well, here's an example of an aquifer, one area along this coast. And this map of saltwater intrusion, put together by measurements of the salinity of water in water wells, shows that saltwater intrusion in this upper aquifer in places has moved up to 10 miles inland. Now, saltwater intrusion in this aquifer started in the 1930s. But people continued to pump the groundwater. And now this region in red can no longer be used as a supply of fresh water. So what do you do when you have saltwater intrusion in this upper aquifer from which you're getting your water? Well, you drill deeper. And so in this area, groundwater is now pumped from the lower aquifer. But when we look at the lower aquifer, we see saltwater intrusion starting into this lower aquifer. To the north and south, to the north there is some evidence of salt water, but the information is very limited. To the south, interestingly, there has been no evidence of salt water intrusion into the ground aquifers that are being used there for the water supply. Well, something that's very obvious is that there's this close connection between freshwater security and proactive groundwater management. So the moment there's evidence of salt water in an aquifer, proactive groundwater management would take actions to prevent the further movement of salt water into your aquifer. The kind of actions that can be taken, first of all, you can reduce the amount of water coming out of the aquifer. You can also think about engineered systems that help get more fresh water into the aquifer. Because this salt water moving in means we're out of balance. The amount of water coming out is greater than the amount of water going in. But any kind of proactive groundwater management, there's an essential part of it. We have to know where the salt water is. We have to know where the salt water is, and ideally, we have to be able to detect that salt water the moment it arrives. Well, in the Seaside Basin, we now have four sentinel wells along the coast. These sentinel wells are watching out for, they're on the lookout for salt water. We have four sentinel wells along the coast. How are these sentinel wells looking out for salt water? Measurements are being made in those wells of electrical resistivity. How do you measure electrical resistivity? You have your electrodes, you inject current, you measure voltage, you calculate your electrical resistivity. And the electrical resistivity you measure is sensitive to the amount of clay in the material, the amount of water in the material, but it's very sensitive to the amount of salt water, to the salinity of the water. As the salinity of the water increases, shown in this plot, increasing concentration of sodium chloride, your electrical resistivity decreases. So back to our sentinel wells, great idea to be measuring electrical resistivity to detect saltwater intrusion. But there's a problem with wells. You're getting a measurement at one specific location. You're sampling a very small volume of the subsurface. So you're not getting the complete picture. You're not capturing the spatial complexity of saltwater intrusion. And what if a tongue of salt water makes its way right between your wells? So what we're suggesting is that, yes, you use electrical resistivity measurements to watch out for salt water along the coast. But we're suggesting that you don't make measurements at one location, but you make millions of measurements all along the coast, using a geophysical method called electrical resistivity imaging. So instead of a measurement at one location, we want to cover the entire coastline making electrical resistivity measurements. This is a type of geophysical imaging method. Geophysical imaging is very much like medical imaging, but instead of getting a slice through a human, you get a slice into the ground. So what we'll get with our electrical resistivity imaging along this coast is an image all along that blue slice, that blue section into the ground, from Monterey to Santa Cruz, we're going to be able to see 300 meters into the ground, watching out for saltwater intrusion. This is what we call sentinel geophysics. We're going to be on the lookout for saltwater through this electrical resistivity measurement. Today, I'm going to talk about the results of a pilot survey that we completed over the last year in this stretch of coast highlighted here in yellow. So how exactly does this work? We're making electrical resistivity measurements by moving a kilometer-long cable along the coast. This cable has 96 electrodes in it that go into the beach. It's a very minimally invasive method, so it's not like drilling a well. You just put these shallow stakes into the beach. We made 130,000 measurements along this stretch. Total coverage was 6.8 kilometers. It took six people, 10 days, and cost us $60,000. And what did we get? Well, the next image is going to look at the electrical resistivity image of this section of coast, this yellow swath part of the coast. So we're going to be looking from the bay at a very colorful geophysical section through this stretch of coast. And here we are. Now, I'm a bit biased, but this is incredible. This is an amazing success. What you're seeing, the color scale goes from blue is fresh water, red is salt water. We are mapping out the distribution of fresh water and salt water along this coast to a depth of 150 meters. Isn't that amazing? Yes, stunning. You can see into the earth. What we're very pleased with, there were the four sentinel wells along this stretch, and we see excellent agreement with the sentinel wells. The color in the wells is the salinity of the water measured in the wells. We get the same color, the same salinity of the water in our geophysical image, but we're covering a much larger section. And another point, the cost estimate for those four wells was $900,000. We did the entire stretch of coast for $60,000. But most importantly, we're capturing the complex spatial distribution of the salt water. We can really start understanding what's happening along this coast. In the south, there's salt water very near the surface, and we've long known that there's salt water in that upper region. The key is the underlying region. That's the source of fresh water. That's the freshwater aquifer for this area. What do we see? Great, blue, fresh water. We have fresh water punching out into Monterey Bay. Another important point we see, very good delineation between this upper red saltwater section and the underlying blue section. So we don't have communication. The salt water is not getting down into our freshwater aquifer. To the north, what do we see? A different story. There's nothing separating the salt water in the top from getting into the area below. So we unfortunately see salt water throughout this entire section, although higher salinity near the top than at the bottom. So what are we planning to do? Join us on the beach this October. We are covering the entire stretch from Santa Cruz to Monterey, a 50-kilometer line. Because it's a longer line, we'll be looking 300 meters below the surface. 8 people, 15 days, $250,000. So before I go to my closing remarks, I do want to acknowledge people who've made this project the success it's been. First of all, Adam Pidlicki and Tara Moran, integral part of the science project, along with my graduate students and postdocs. This has just been a real team effort. I also have to thank the people who gave us all the logistical support, including 85 individual landowners, some of whom could be out here, who are letting us walk along their beach this fall. And then financial support, which makes it possible at Stanford to do cutting-edge research while solving real-world problems. This real-world problem being an important local problem. So I'll conclude by asking you as you leave today to go out of here thinking about fresh water security. How can people get the fresh water they need without damaging those natural systems that are the source of our fresh water? And of course, I also hope you'll leave here thinking about Sentinel Geophysics, because I am convinced that Sentinel Geophysics is truly the type of advanced technology we need for proactive, effective groundwater management, which is the base for building freshwater security. Thanks very much.